Hare Krishna. So grateful to be here amongst all of you today. And today I'll speak on the topic of divine friendship. The bhakti tradition reveals God in a very special way. In the biblical tradition, it is said God is great. And yes, God is great. And in some ways, how great God is revealed in the Bhagavad-Gita's display of the universal form. Whole universe is contained within Him. So His greatness is what often attracts submission. Say if you are having some discussion with someone, maybe politics, sports, fashion, technology, whatever it is. Now I may have my opinion, you may have your opinion. But if I come to know that, say, you have a double PhD in that subject, then immediately an understanding your position will bring some submission. So like that, understanding God's greatness brings submission. But submission alone is not enough for a loving relationship. So there is God's greatness which brings submission, and there is God's sweetness which brings affection. Janma karma cha me devyam evam yo vetti tatvatah tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti so arjuna. So Krishna says that janma karma cha me devyam, understand my leela, my pastimes, tatvatah, in truth, then you will become so attracted to me that you will come to me and not come back to this world. So we could say devotion has this combination of submission and affection. Now normally, Krishna, how does He manifest His sweetness? There are many different ways. His childhood pastimes are sweet. But one way sweetness is manifested is through vulnerability. What do I mean by vulnerability? The world is a tough place. And because of that, it's sometimes cruelly competitive. And if anybody, any slight weakness is seen in someone, world will smash that person at that weakness. If say two people are fighting a boxing match, and say one of the boxers just grazes the jaw of the other boxer, and he grazes the jaw and the other boxer winces, immediately this boxer will understand, hey, he's got a weakness over here, he's got maybe some previous wound over here, and he will hit that boxer right at that point till that boxer is defeated. So the principle in any competition is hit where it hurts. So in general, we conceal our weaknesses and we put on a front of being strong. But we can't always keep putting on this front. So in front of some people, we have to put down our front. And whom do we do that in front of? Say if there is somebody very powerful, very influential, and they always have solutions to every problem, and then one day they tell us, actually, you know, this particular issue, I don't know what we should do about it. If you do like this, this will happen. If you do like this, this will happen. Now we might see that, oh, I thought you were perfect, you're not perfect. That might lead, if we are only in that mode of like a fan worshipping a star, then that might bring that image down. But if you are interested in a personal relationship, what will happen is that admission of vulnerability will actually increase intimacy. Whom do we talk about? Whom do we talk with about our vulnerability? It is with someone whom we trust. So for any relationship to be meaningful, there are many aspects to it. One very important aspect in a relationship is that we should feel needed in that relationship. We want to feel loud, but just loud is okay, but we want to feel needed in that relationship. Otherwise, the relationship, you feel, okay, what am I doing in this relationship? Now, Krishna as God is perfect. Because He's perfect, He doesn't need anyone. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamutachyate. It is completely perfect. No matter how many units come out of him, he still remains perfect and complete. So he doesn't need anyone. And if he doesn't need anyone, then how can anyone have a relationship with him in which they are felt to be needed? For that to happen, Krishna exhibits vulnerability. The Supreme, who is completely invulnerable, he exhibits vulnerability. Krishna, as a small baby, starts becoming restless and crying when he is hungry. And Mother Yashoda feels, if I don't feed Krishna on time, he will become weak, he will become sick, he may even die. And thus, she feels needed in that relationship. And in general, if we want to go close in any relationship, we need to exhibit some vulnerability. And then, we shall say some issues which are troubling us, other person says tell some issues that are troubling them, and then we come closer to each other. So Krishna also does the same thing. And this applies especially in the Vatsalya Ras, where Krishna puts himself in the position of dependence to his mother. But this also applies in his Sakya Ras. Now, God is the father of everyone. He is the source of everyone. So he can't have a parent. But in order to relish the full gamut of relationships that we all aspire to relish, Krishna puts himself in the vulnerable position of being an infant who needs his mother. And similarly, in friendship usually it's a relationship of equals. Now, one of the sayings in the Upanishads, which the Prabhupada would often quote, is that natat samas chabhya adikascha drushyate natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate. That absolute truth, nobody is equal and nobody is superior to what? Asamurdhva, as I said. So how can there be friendship? So again, Krishna exhibits vulnerability. So he acts in his friendly relationships that sometimes the friends are in trouble and they need him. And sometimes he has some situation for which he needs them. So to understand Krishna and the relationship with Krishna, we need to first begin by appreciating this concept of how the invulnerable becomes vulnerable or appears to become vulnerable to become more lovable. He is worshipable, but Krishna doesn't just want a worshipable relationship with him. He wants a lovable relationship. And thus, the invulnerable becomes vulnerable to appear more lovable. Now let's look at this dynamic of lovability as manifested through vulnerability in three different relationships which Krishna exhibits with three different individuals in the flavor of friendship. So broadly speaking, Krishna Leela, if you consider 90 chapters in the 10th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the first 40 chapters describe Vrindavan. The next 10 chapters are about Krishna in Mathura. And the remaining 40 chapters are of Krishna in Dwarka. But actually, out of those 40 chapters, Krishna is in Dwarka for a very short while. Most of those chapters are incidents that happen when Krishna is based in Dwarka but is traveling everywhere. It's like when somebody is a small child, the child children, unless their parents travel, they don't travel much. They may just play in their back courtyard, or Krishna may go out to the nearby Vrindavan forests. So that's why most of the pastimes are localized to Vrindavan, the children. So we'll look at a friendship of Krishna in Vrindavan, then another friendship in Dwarka, and another friendship when he was based in Dwarka and traveling to various places. So let's go through this linearly. When Krishna is in Vrindavan, now he has many different friends. Some of the friends are gopas like him. So Sudama and others, they are gopas. And Krishna goes out the forest with them. And although there are the four varanas, sometimes when we hear about the four varnas, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, we think of them as we may think of them like watertight categories. But any conceptual system of classification, when it is translated into reality, there are always porous holes over there. It's just like if you consider America and Canada, on the map you might say this is Canada ending, America beginning. But if you go walking over there, where exactly is America and where does Canada begin? You might say it's this river. Okay. But is it like 50% of this river is in America, 50% Canada? You can't have that neat division. So the point I'm making is, although Madhumangala is a Brahmana and Krishna is a Vaishya. Of course, Krishna is beyond the Varnashram, but when he manifests in the world, he plays the role of a Vaishya. So although Krishna is born in the Vaishya family and Madhumangala is born in the Brahmana family, but because in Vraja, everyone is primarily a pastoral community. So even Madhumangala goes out and plays with Krishna. And Madhumangala goes out and plays with Krishna and they go to the forest. And Brahmanas also have cows which they take care of. But Brahmana's primary duty is not taking care of cows. So we see many times that the kings, when they give charity, they give charity of cows to the Brahmanas. Now if the cows have given charity to the Brahmanas, who is going to take care of them? The Brahmanas own the cows, but they give the cows to Vaishyas for taking care of charity. But in childhood, children play. So just as all the small boys from Vrindavan go to the forest to play. So Krishna also goes, and at that time Madhumangala also goes with him. Now when Krishna and Madhumangala go to play, at that time Madhumangala is in some ways the comedian in Krishna Leela. He always knows how to, he doesn't necessarily have to be humorous, he just spontaneously is humorous. So first time when Radharani has grown up a little bit, she has come to her early teens, at that time Nanda Maharaj and his whole family is invited to Barsana for lunch. And then Krishna initially says, I don't want to go, I want to play with my friends. But then his friends tell him, I've heard that Rishabhanu Maharaj, there's going to be a big feast there. Let's all go there. So then Krishna initially tells Mother Yashoda, I'll not go, I want to play with my friends. But then, now he doesn't say, I want to go. He says, my friends want to go. So I'll also go. So then they all go together. And then, so Krishna is sitting and Krishna sits down at taking prasadam. So Balram sits on one side of him. Next to Balram is Nanda Maharaj. And next to him is Madhumangala. And when the prasad is served, now the whole of Vrindavan, their dream is that Radha and Krishna should get together. So this is a portion when they tell, Yashoda tells Radha, you go and serve Krishna. So she serves prasad food to everyone. And then Madhumangala eats the food. And Krishna has a peacock with him, a parrot with him. And that parrot's name is also Madhu. And Madhumangala's short name is also Madhu. So then Madhumangala eats that food, and Madhumangala says, oh my God. He says, this food has put me in great anxiety. And normally if somebody serves you food and you say, food has put me in great anxiety. What do you mean? What happened? They have not cooked properly, naturally everybody gets a little concerned. And Krishna tells Madhumangala, stop being so naughty. Now Krishna is naughty, but Krishna says, stop being so naughty. What happened? He says, I am in anxiety, how can I stop myself? He says, so then Balram, what is your anxiety? He says, this food is so delicious. that I am worried after this, how will I be satisfied with any other food?
So,
there are often straight ways of giving compliments and there are indirect ways of giving compliments. So then, Krishna, oh, Madhumangala, just keep quiet and eat some food now. So then, Krishna and Madhumangala start having a banter. And Radharani is watching, all the Barsanavasis are watching. And Krishna and Madhumangala, they are such close friends. Seeing their friendship, seeing their cheerful exchanges, everybody becomes joyful. Most of the interactions between Krishna and Madhumangala are centered on food. In general, it is said Brahmanas are bhojana priya. That the generally Brahmanas, it's said that they have two main duties and both are done with the mouth. One is to take food and the other is to speak some spiritual wisdom. So Prabhupada used to say that in modern times the Brahmanas are only doing the first, not the second. They just take dakshina and take food, but they don't teach anything. And that's why in India much of the culture is getting lost, because the wisdom underlying it is not known to people. So now of course Madhumangala is a small boy. So Madhumangala says that he likes to eat food. And many times what Krishna does is, Krishna and Madhumangala, as I said, they interact on food. And in this case, Krishna knows Madhumangala is a Brahmana, but Krishna doesn't really respect Madhumangala as a Brahmana, because they are children. But he is very much there to point out to others, he is a Brahmana and don't dare offend him. So once what happens? Krishna takes his Gopa friends to steal butter. And when they go to steal butter, at that time, Krishna and Madhumangala, because he's Bhojana Priya, he's a little stocky. And they eat butter, and everybody runs away. And the gopis come over there, and among the gopis, there are young gopis, there are older gopis. The gopis come to catch, and Krishna runs away, and all the other gopas run away. Only one Gopa is left over there. Who is that? Madhumangala. And Madhumangala always, he says, Krishna, you do the mischief and I get caught. So he gets caught. And then, now Krishna also, at one level, he wants to have fun. But he doesn't want Madhumangala to get into trouble. So he sees that he runs away and then he realizes, oh, Madhumangala is not there. When we are in trouble, we just want to scoot away. But after that trouble has gone away, they look around, who is missing? So, yeah, Madhumangala is missing. Then Krishna makes a plan. And Krishna goes back, acting as if he is just visiting over there. Not that he just ran away from there. He is just passing by. And the gopis have caught Madhumangala. And Krishna sees them and he becomes alarmed. He says, what are you doing? He says, what? He is a thief. He says, he is a Brahmana. If you abuse a Brahmana, you will be committing a Brahma aprad. And there is no greater disaster than that. Now Madhumangala is so frightened. See, that actually when he's a small child and children when they're hungry, they just forget everything else. So most children live, at least in the early years, in Annamaya Kosh. Annamaya Kosh means what? It is a level of consciousness where all of existence is potential food.
All of existence is potential food. So children experience, especially infants, they experience the world through the tongue. So they'll put their fingers in the tongue, they'll put their toes in the tongue, they'll put their toys in the tongue. So they experience it like that.
So Madhumangala is initially, he's panicking. Hey, I've been caught. And then, when Krishna looks very grave, and Krishna says, he is a Brahmana, how dare you? Aren't you afraid of offending him? And immediately Madhumangala gets the plan. And immediately gets the plan. Where is my thread? I am going to curse all of you now. And very immediately assumes his almost regal, brahminical bearing. And the gopis become scared. He says, oh no, 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 please, please don't curse us, please don't curse us. And then, now Krishna and Madhumangala, they are such close friends that immediately, the two people when they are close to each other, they don't have to speak words to communicate. Just with your eyes you can communicate. Just a little gesture or even some little hand gesture also. Okay, this is the plan, you understand that. Now when two people's hearts are close to each other, just a glance can communicate volumes. But when people's hearts are apart, even screams can't communicate anything. They scream and yell, but the other person doesn't hear anything. So Krishna and Madhumangala both understand what the plan is. And then what happens? Then Krishna and Madhumangala play along. So Madhumangala, I'm a Brahmana, where is my thread? I'm going to curse you. He said, no, 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 please don't curse. And Madhumangala is very angry. I'm going to curse. How dare you catch me like this? How dare you manhandle me like this? And then the gopis become panicky. No, no, no. And Madhumangala is so angry, they turn toward Krishna. Krishna, please help us. See, Madhumangala is a Brahmana. If he becomes angry, he will destroy every one of you. But there is one way you can please him. What is that? Give him prasad, give him laddus, give him sweets, give him delicious food items. He says, yes, yes, of course, everything that we have is there, yours. And now, in this way, the things that Krishna and Madhumangala had come to steal earlier, all that and more, the gopis willingly give to Krishna and Madhumangala. And in this way, Krishna and Madhumangala, in their childhood, are partners in crime. So, now if you see, in this particular pastime, in the flavor in Vrindavan, they said, Krishna doesn't always exhibit his godhood. When needed, he will exhibit his godhood. Other times, he just acts like an ordinary small boy. And similarly, Krishna doesn't really talk much about Madhumangala's brahminical position unless it is needed. Most of the times, it is, oh, he's just one among us. And this particular flavor of the relationship between Krishna and Madhumangala, it is so special that even Brahmaji can't understand it. That once Krishna and Balaram and all the gopas, they have gone to the forest and they are sitting around near the Yamuna in a circle taking their food. Many of you may have seen that beautiful picture of Krishna taking prasad. So at that time when Krishna is taking that food, so at that time you notice, hey, Madhumangala is not here. Where is Madhumangala gone? Now Madhumangala is from a Brahmana family. Then Brahmanas are generally not very wealthy. When they get charity, they may have a lot. But charity is never reliable. Sometimes he doesn't have much. So on that day, from his home, he has got some chaach, some buttermilk. And he feels this buttermilk is not of such a good quality that Krishna can take it. So he thinks, what now, once we sit down to eat, then Krishna, if he sees this, he will want it. And if he wants it, I can't say no at that time. So he decides, I'll just sneak away behind a thicket of trees and I will drink the buttermilk myself. And then I won't have to give it to Krishna. He feels it's not good enough for Krishna. And then he goes behind and he starts drinking. And he drinks. At that time, Krishna looks up, hey, where is Madhumangala? And starts noticing, looking, starts searching, and he says, oh, Madhumangala is behind that tree. And Krishna comes over there, and Madhumangala sees, Madhumangala got a small pot. So he sees Krishna coming, and he becomes anxious, and he drinks everything. And as he drinks it, now suppose if we drink too much water or buttermilk, then our cheeks swell out. So now he drinks it all, and he finishes the pot. He thinks, oh, now I won't have to give this to Krishna. And Krishna comes running over there and Madhumangala is happy. It's like, hey, the pot is over. But Krishna comes up. Krishna slaps his cheeks. and when he slaps his cheeks, so some of the buttermilk from his mouth comes out. And the buttermilk falls and goes and falls on Krishna's body, Krishna's arms, Krishna's chest. And Krishna starts touching it and drinking it. And when Brahmaji sees this from above, Brahmaji gets a violent cultural shock. He gets a, what's happening? How can this happen? He actually, for somebody who is not familiar with traditional culture, maybe traditional Indian culture, I was once traveling with some Western or Westernized people, and in India we have this concept of what we call as jhuta. If you have eaten something, then you normally don't have somebody else eat from that same plate. So I have usually carry a water bottle with me and I drink it by touching my mouth. So then we were driving a long ride for 3-4 hours, and the other people, they were devotees of a kind. So I was thirsty, I drank some water, they said, we are thirsty, can you give some water? I said, no, actually, now there is not even a proper word in English for jhuta. You can say remnants, but it doesn't convey anything. So then I said that, no, actually, in our tradition, if you touch your mouth to some water or any food, we don't give it to anyone else. And then immediately, you mean if I am dying of thirst, you won't give me water? So, this whole concept is not so easily communicable for. But for somebody who understands the concept of purity, first of all, well, Brahmaji can't understand. See, this boy who is eating something which has fallen on his body, how can this be God? And it's not just fallen on his body, but it's fallen from somebody's mouth. How can he eat that? And on top of that, he knows Madhumangala is a Brahmana. So as a Brahmana, even he doesn't have the culture to understand that he should not give something like this to Krishna. So that whole incident is incomprehensible for Brahmaji. And that's why he decides to test Krishna. And as he causes all the gopas to disappear, is Krishna really God? So it's all triggered by this sweet pastime between Krishna and Madhumangala, where the intimacy of the love overshadows the awareness of the Godhood. So Krishna is not concerned for Brahmaji when he's offering. There are proper mantras chanted and the food is offered with great purity. We do something similar when we offer food to the deities. But for Madhumangal, Krishna is so eager that in the food from his mouth, Krishna wants to take that. So in Vrindavan, the flavor is of pure intimacy, where Krishna doesn't exhibit, nor does Madhumangala, nobody goes around throwing about the weight of their position. So he says very close intimacy. Now as Krishna moves away, if you see, one of the names of Krishna is Brahmana Priya. Namo Brahmanya Devaya Go Brahmanaitaya, as we say. So, although Madhumangala is a Brahmana, it's more of close friendship without much awareness that he is a Brahmana or he is God. It's just two friends being together always. Then when Krishna is in Vrindavan, from Vrindavan he goes to Mathura, from Mathura he goes to Dwarka. Now, Krishna's interactions with Arjuna happen throughout, over many, many years repeatedly. Now we have primarily one major interaction of Krishna with Sudama. I'll talk about that and then we'll go to Arjuna. So now Krishna and Sudama, they meet in the Gurukul of Sandipani Muni. Now Krishna, he has lived as a Vaishya and he has trained as a Vaishya, but suddenly he's thrust into the role of a Kshatriya. And he goes to a Gurukul and he just does fast forward of everything. He learns all the Kshatriya, all that is to be learned in the Gurukul in a very short while. But even during that time, he makes friends. One of the friends is Sudama. Generally, in a Gurukul, there has to be So generally, walls have to be built before they can be broken. What does that mean? That means that there has to be certain understanding of training of what is to be done and what is not to be done. And then first we need to learn the rules, and then we may learn exceptions for the rules. Okay, this is how things are to be done, but sometimes in an emergency, this is not how it's to be done. So for example, the normal traffic rules. This is on this side you travel, on this side you travel. But if there's an emergency, if somebody is about to die and there's ambulance going, then the rules don't apply. But although there are exceptions to the rules, that doesn't mean the rules themselves are not important. So now in childhood, just as there was not much distance of awareness of positions between Krishna and Madhumangala, similarly, there's not much awareness of difference of position between Krishna and Sudama. These became very close friends. And then they went their separate ways. The Bhagavatam gives the example that we are all like twigs. Now, twigs in a river, based on the currents of the river, we come together. And the currents of the river move us separately, then we just move apart. So Sudama goes his way, Krishna goes his way. And then Sudama eventually is in great poverty. So we may wonder, this is the time of Krishna and Sudama is a Brahmana. So how can he be poor? Or wherein Brahmana is always taken care of? Actually, not always. Krishna says, Sakalene hamata yogo nashta parantapa. That at the time when he has come, because of the effect of Kala, the pure Dharma is disappearing. And that's why he has come to restore Dharma. That means the society and the culture that are described in the Mahabharata, the Bhagavad, Krishna is not saying, at least that what is described when Krishna was present, Krishna is not saying this is the ideal. He says things have deviated from the ideal and he has come to restore the ideal. So there are some places where Brahmanas were taken care of well, others they were not. So in general, if what somebody is giving is valued, then the giver is valued. So if somebody doesn't have spiritual inclination, then anybody gives spiritual knowledge, what is the value of that? So in a materialistic culture, spiritual knowledge is not valued. And so Sudama was quite poor. And then his wife told him that, please, You have Krishna who is Dwarkadhi, she is your friend. Just go and ask him for some help. He says, we are in such great poverty. He says, we have a child, we have a son who is weak, who is starving. Please go. Now he doesn't want to go to seek help from Krishna. But then when his wife requests him repeatedly, he says, okay, I'll take this as a reason to go and at least see Krishna. And then when he is going, at that time, he says, give me something to carry with me. There's a gift to Krishna and she has nothing. So she just has some simple chipped rice. And she packs it in a small bag for him and he carries with him. And now when he goes to meet Krishna, he is also apprehensive. On one level, he has heard about how Krishna is so kind to the Brahmanas. He's also knows how Krishna was such a sweet person in his childhood. But when we meet somebody after many years, we don't know how time has changed them, how time has changed us. And when we meet somebody, if we meet somebody unknown entirely, then we are on our guard. If we meet somebody who is known, then we are a little more relaxed. But it's somebody who is known, who may have gone through some unknown changes, then we don't know how to react. So he's a little apprehensive at that time. While he's apprehensive, he goes in. And Krishna sees Sudama is delighted. He gets off his throne and embraces him and brings him and sits him on his own throne and does his Pada Puja. And he lavishes such honor and affection on Madhumangala. He's completely overwhelmed. And then, after that, Krishna says, Madhumangala, you must have, sorry, not Madhumangala, Sudama. Sudama, you must have brought some, what have you brought for me? Now Sudama, he is seeing the magnificence of the palace. Now, if somebody has lived in a small village and they come to a city, oh, such big houses also exist, I didn't even know. They say such big houses, such regal opulence. Say, what is this food? How can I give it to him? He says, no, I don't have anything. And he doesn't want Krishna to notice, so he wants to hide it. Now he doesn't even have any pockets in which to hide it. A simple Brahmana, so he'll have to put it behind. Krishna says, no, give it to me. And Krishna takes a chipped rice and he eats it. And he says, this is delicious. And he wants to eat more. And then Rukmini says, you know, just by eating one morsel, you satisfied the whole universe. And now, Krishna has much, much more opulent food which he can get anywhere. Why is Krishna so eager for this food that Sudama is giving him? In the 7th chapter of the Bhagavad-Gita, Krishna talks about 4 kinds of people who come to him. In 7.16 and 7.17 it said, Krishna says, Udara sarva evaite. Udara means broad-hearted, means charitable. They're all charitable. Now, Ramanujacharya in his Bhagavad-Gita commentary asks that normally we would consider God or somebody wealthy to be charitable. We won't consider somebody needy to be charitable. All these people who are coming to Krishna are needy. So how can the needy be considered charitable? They need wealth, they need relief from their problems, they need knowledge. How can they be considered charitable? So he describes that Krishna as Lakshmipati, he is the Lord, the goddess of fortune, he owns everything except one thing. And that one thing which Krishna can't own is our heart. And Krishna wants that. Krishna is hungry for the love of the souls of, and not just the souls, of every soul. And therefore he feels that if any soul comes and offers a little devotion to him, even if it is tainted by some self-centered motive, still, at least you are offering your worship and devotion to me. Oh, you are so charitable, Krishna says. So, this is Krishna, he is hungry for love. And he feels, again I talked about vulnerability in the beginning. So, the vulnerability is not just in terms of physical vulnerability. Oh, I am hungry, I need some food. It's also, Krishna exhibits purely spiritual, emotional vulnerability. That without my devotees, I feel incomplete. I want the love of my devotees. And thus, when Sudama gives that chipped rice to Krishna, Krishna feels so touched because he's not tasting the rice. He's tasting the love of the heart of his devotee. And then Sudama is so happy to be received so warmly by Krishna, to spend time with Krishna. Both of them have very sweet reminiscences of all that they did. And then Sudama forgets why he had come there. And he goes back. Like you go to somebody to ask something, but you get so caught that you forget it. That shows Madhumangala's transcendence. Just so much filled with love for Krishna, he doesn't have the desire to ask Krishna for anything. And he forgets it also. But Krishna doesn't forget. Now Vishwamitra Thakur says that Krishna knew what Sudama wanted. But then why didn't Krishna give it to Sudama straight? He could have. Krishna felt that Sudama, his love for me is so pure that although he has such great need for this, he's not asking me for anything. Therefore, he said, how can I ever repay such love? Just like Krishna tells the gopis, Napa Rayaham, that service you have performed, I cannot repay it. Similarly, Krishna feels, I cannot repay the love that Sudama has offered me. And because it cannot be a proper exchange, what I will give is just a small token. And therefore, he gives it secretly. By the time Sudama comes back and he sees his small cottage has disappeared. And in front of the big palace has come over there. And he sees his wife who is earlier wearing simple clothes. Now she is wearing magnificent clothes. His children are also dressed opulently. And now that is itself a miracle. But the bigger miracle is that Sudama, he doesn't get captivated by this. He takes this as Krishna's mercy, but he still becomes absorbed in Krishna. So in every relationship, to some extent, there is some kind of reciprocation. Reciprocation means we do something for the person, other person, they do something for us. So in every relationship, there is some contribution that we make and there's some expectation from others. So now, the best relationship is where both do their part and there is no need for anyone to tell their expectations. The worst situation is, each person says, I am doing so much for you, what are you doing for me? Another person says, I am doing so much for you, what are you doing for me? So the sweetest is where both just do their part and the other person understands what is needed and provides that. So when Sudama comes to Krishna, he just wants to be with Krishna, he wants to offer his love to Krishna, and that chipped rice is just a means by which he offers that love. So, and Krishna knows what Sudama needs. Sudama doesn't even have to ask, and Krishna doesn't make it also, I am doing a big favor to you. Krishna just, so what is required, it is automatically done. So that is a special flavor of the intimacy. So here there is give and take. But the give and take is not the center point of the relationship. The give and take just happens by the side. The real substance of the relationship is the reciprocation of the heart, the reciprocation of the love. And if something is to be given and taken, that's done on the side. So here, of course, Krishna and Sudama both have grown up. Krishna and Madhumangala just play, it's childhood play. And we could say Vrindavan is like an idyllic world where we aspire to go. But to go to Vrindavan, how to live so that we can go to Vrindavan, that is described in many ways by Krishna's pastimes in Mathura, Dwarka, Kurukshetra, and other places. So this particular, we want that pure loving relationship with Krishna, unconcerned with everything else in the world, that Krishna and Madhumangala exhibit. But while we are functioning in this world, Krishna and Sudama describe, they demonstrate how actually the sweetness of the relationship is both just focus on the relationship and everything else is incidental to the relationship. Now, of course, this is where Krishna and Sudama don't have like a constant service to do together. They just have this one interaction, one very sweet and endearing interaction. But what about when we have to constantly interact with someone or repeatedly interact with someone? That is what happens between Krishna and whom?
Arjuna.
So Krishna and Arjuna, they are friends, and they are not just friends for friendship's sake. They're friends who are on a mission together. Now, of course, Krishna and Sudama had also gone on the mission once when they had gone to get some firewood for their guru and they had got lost in the forest. But that was like a small mission.
For them, of course, it was very serious. It's a service to the guru. But Krishna and Arjuna, when eventually they had to fight wars, at that time,
it was a matter of life and death, and not just for them, but for their loved ones, for their citizens. A very serious matter. And how do they interact over here? So I'll talk about two main incidents in this particular dynamism. It's a whole class in itself about Krishna and Arjuna's interactions. Mm-hmm. The first major devotional interaction between Krishna and Arjuna happens in Kandava. Krishna and Arjuna meet for the first time after Draupadi Swayamvar. And Arjuna appears and wins Draupadi's hand. And after that, when they all go back to the small place where they are staying as Brahmanas, Krishna comes over there. And Krishna introduces himself. He says, "I am Krishna and this is my brother Balram." And the Pandavas are so happy. They say, "Of course, we know you." But they never met each other. And then all of them become very close to each other. But Krishna and Arjuna, we may say, they hit off. They just become very close. They just naturally gel with each other. And now Jiva Goswami explains that among the five Pandavas, why is it that Krishna and Arjuna become the closest to each other? There can be different explanations. Jiva Goswami in Gopal Champu explains everything from the perspective of Vrindavan. He says even when Krishna leaves Vrindavan, he's still thinking about Vrindavan. He's still remembering Vrindavan. And he says that Krishna has a Gopa friend in Vrindavan whose name is Arjun. So Krishna doesn't have any friend over there whose name is Nakula, Sahadev, Yudhishthir or Bhim. So this Arjun reminds him of that Arjun who is from Vrindavan. So because this Arjun reminds him of Vrindavan, Krishna becomes very close to Arjun. Now, of course, this is one reason. Arjun himself has great devotion. That's another reason. But we see the sweetness of Raja in this explanation as manifested to Jiva Goswami's devotional heart. Now, the two incidents when Krishna and Arjuna are there in Khandav. So at that time, they are sitting and talking, and at that time Agnidev comes over there as a Brahmana, and he says this forest is filled with dangerous, sinful demons who are now assumed the bodies of animals, and they are wreaking havoc over here and they will wreak havoc everywhere else. So he said, "I need this forest as ahuti, as an offering for me." And then Arjuna uses his celestial weapons to put the whole forest on fire, and Agnidev starts eating that, and the ball of fire starts consuming it. And then Indra has a friend over there, and Indra starts showering rains. And then Krishna and Arjuna, there is their first fight together. So what happens over there? Krishna for the first time becomes the charioteer of Arjuna. And Arjuna is actually, he starts fighting on three fronts. First, he shoots arrows in such a way that the whole Khandavaprastha becomes covered as an umbrella by his arrows. And the rains are showering heavily, so that umbrella made of arrows will break. And Arjuna is shooting arrows and repairing that. Anywhere that's breaking, he's fixing it. Now, simultaneous with that, as the demons from that forest, they see the forest is burning and they start fleeing, Krishna and Arjuna are going round and round that forest. And any demons who try to escape, Arjuna shoots them. Now, on top of that, there are devatas. When Indra sees that his plan of showering down rains is stopped, is being thwarted, he calls the devatas and they all start attacking Arjuna. So Arjuna is fighting against them also. So it's magnificent. On three fronts he is fighting. It's like sometimes you could say there are some maybe tennis player or sports player or cricket player might be playing in some local clubs. and they burst on the international scene. And suppose that sports player makes a double century. In their first match, they make a triple century. You create a sensation. So this is the fight by which Arjuna bursts, not just on the global scene, but on the universal scene. And even the devatas are stunned to see the sheer prowess of Arjuna. How can anyone fight like this on three fronts? And Indra is shooting. Now Krishna, Arjuna is the son of Indra at one level. And he just keeps attacking more and more to see how strong Arjuna is. And finally, Indra, all his weapons are used. The gods, all their weapons are used. And Arjuna is still standing, fighting, triumphant. And Indra becomes so pleased with him at that time. And at that time, Mayadana, various things happen over there. There's a Maya who's a demon who comes and takes shelter of not Krishna but of Arjuna. And then from Arjuna, from he goes to Krishna. Either way, he gets shelter. Then there are benedictions to be asked. So then normally the devatas, whenever they give darshan, the idea is that they will give some ashirvad, some benediction. So Indra tells Arjuna, and Krishna, he says, the heroism you have exhibited is extraordinary. So ask for some boons. Now it's interesting at this point, Arjuna, he says, please bless me, please give me your celestial weapons. And Indra smiles and says, I'll give this to you later. And then now Krishna has to ask. Now of course Krishna is the god of Indra also. But Krishna is playing the role of a human being over here. And thus, when Indra asks for benediction, what does Krishna ask for? Krishna says, may my friendship with Arjuna go on forever unimpeded. So here, it is Krishna values the friendship of Arjuna so much that he is asking that as a benediction. So he doesn't need any benediction, but that reveals his heart. How much of a value he gives to that friendship. Doesn't want it to be lost at all. And then the Krishna and Arjuna have many sweet interactions together, some fierce interactions together, like through thick and thin, they are together. And then comes, so the first battle which they fight together, and then there is the last battle, that is in Kurukshetra. And in that battle, the 13th night and the 14th day are the most intense. On the 13th day in the Kurukshetra war, Abhimanyu is slaughtered and Arjuna is shattered. And at that time, Arjuna just crumbles in agony and then he rises in fury, starts lashing out at everyone, starts lashing out at his brothers. He says, all their weapons, are they just ornaments? You couldn't protect my son. And then he turns towards Krishna. And he says, Krishna, Krishna, you must have known what happened to Abhimanyu. Why didn't you tell me? So now, here, Krishna doesn't take the role. I am God, how dare you challenge my judgment? How dare you question my plan? Actually, Krishna is very understanding over here. And sometimes when something terrible goes wrong in our lives, we might feel very upset. So one devotee, I was in Australia, one devotee was telling me that he says, I'm feeling very angry with Krishna. Can I feel angry with Krishna? I said, what do you mean? If you are feeling angry, you cannot just wish away your feeling. He says that, whatever feeling might be there, don't let it interrupt your relationship with Krishna. Because God is big enough to accommodate even our anger. Of course, we understand that God's plan is supreme. But even Draupadi, she is upset with Krishna. She says, Krishna, I called you when I was in the assembly, I was being dishonored. Why didn't you come? Now, of course, the sari got extended, but she didn't see Krishna coming over there. And Krishna again doesn't say, I am God, how dare you question me? He just says, I didn't know. I was fighting a war with a demon who had attacked Dwarka. As soon as I came to know, immediately I came here. So here, there is a time for speaking philosophy and there is a time for manifesting humanity. Just connecting at a human level. So Krishna doesn't defend himself, Krishna doesn't criticize Arjuna. What does Krishna say? Oh Arjuna, those who are in grief, the wise try to decrease their grief, not increase it. He says, Abhimanyu was not just your son. Abhimanyu, the son of all of us. See your brothers, they are in as much grief as you are. Please don't speak words that will worsen their grief. So Krishna calms Arjuna down. And then Yudhishthira tells the whole story of how Abhimanyu was so brutally slaughtered because of the intervention of Jayadrath. Arjuna's agony changes to anger. When it changes to anger, he takes that vow. By tomorrow night, sunset, I will either slay Jayadrath or I will enter into fire. And then all the Pandavas become excited for fight. They all start blowing their conches. And then after that, when they're going back, at that time, they're going back to their tent. Krishna and Arjuna stay in the same tent. They're very close to each other. So Krishna tells Arjuna, oh Arjuna, you got excited by your passion and you took a rash vow. Tomorrow, Drona will do everything to thwart you. You have courted death by taking a vow like this. You should have consulted me before doing this. And then Arjuna says, Krishna, I cannot understand your anxiety. He says, you know my power and I know your power. So what is there to worry? And then Krishna and Arjuna go to their tent and Arjuna has a long day fighting. So Arjuna, he goes to sleep and Krishna is not able to sleep. Krishna is thinking about the next day's fight. And then he's walking, pacing around restlessly. And then by his mystic power, he summons his charioteer, Daruka. And he tells him that, keep my chariot with all my best weapons. Just on the side of Kurukshetra battlefield. He says, if Arjuna is not able to finish his fulfill his vow, he says, I will jump from Arjuna's chariot here to my chariot and I will destroy all the Kauravas. And Daruka is overwhelmed to see the extent, the depth of Krishna's love for his devotees. And then he says, yes, of course, I'll make all arrangements. And then Krishna goes back and Krishna sees Arjuna is fast asleep. And Krishna says, such are my devotees. They go to sleep and give me sleepless nights. So, here in this, we see Krishna at one level is a friend, but Krishna is also the protector. At one level, it is Arjuna who is doing all the fighting. But at another level, it is Krishna who is making all the arrangements. It is Krishna who is there to guide Arjuna at the right time. It is Krishna who is there to make everything right so that Arjuna wins. So in many ways, our relationship with Krishna will mirror the relationship of Krishna and Arjuna. Not in terms of intimacy. Arjuna is a great devotee, but the body is also like a chariot. And we as the souls are in charge of this chariot. And Krishna can become our charioteer. Our own mind and our own worldly intelligence can be our charioteer, or Krishna can be our charioteer. And if Prabhupada said in an initiation lecture, in the second initiation lecture that he gave, where High Guru Prabhu and others got initiated, Prabhupada said, now when you take initiation, you have made Krishna the charioteer of your life. Now whatever happens, do not lament. You serve Krishna and he will lead you to safety. So for all of us, we often face great difficulties in life. And we have to do our part. Arjuna fought to the best of his capacity to win the wars. Similarly, we do have to fight. But often we may feel, I am doing so much and Krishna is not doing anything for me. But actually Krishna is acting in hundreds of ways that we are not even aware of. It is whenever we succeed in life, it is we may say, I did this right, I did this right, I did this right. Yes, it's true, we did those things right. But there were so many other things that also went right. If all of those had gone wrong, we would have not succeeded. So Krishna is always with us, just like he was always with Arjuna. And just as Krishna was a non-combatant, Krishna himself did not raise weapons in the Kurukshetra war. Similarly, in our lives in this world, Krishna is almost invisible. We don't see him. Although Krishna was invisible, Krishna's influence in the war for Arjuna's sake was not only undeniable, it was irresistible. At all the critical times, Krishna gave decisive guidance. Krishna made the necessary arrangements. So for a devotee, Krishna is making those arrangements. Krishna will give us guidance from within. Krishna will clear the path in a devotee's life. Now, if that does not seem to be happening, then that means simply that Krishna wants us to grow. Sometimes struggle is what is required for our growth. And when we are struggling, it is not that Krishna is not helping us. Krishna is helping us by giving us the strength to struggle so that we can grow big enough so that we can fly towards him. We can ultimately attain him. I'll conclude with one metaphor. Now, when a bird is very small inside the nest, inside the shell, at that time for it to come out, it requires a lot of effort. It requires an enormous amount of effort. There's a difference between, say, how human babies are delivered and, say, birds' babies are delivered. Now, human babies, the mother has to exert a lot to get the baby out. But the egg is already delivered outside. And in birds, the baby has to struggle on its own to come out. So similarly, for all of us, we are covered by a shell of ignorance, of our worldly attachments, of our worldly illusions. And through our difficulties, we are breaking that shell. Now Krishna can break that shell in one moment. Just like the mother bird, if she wants, she can just crack and she can break the egg. But if the mother bird breaks the egg and the baby bird comes out, the bird may come out without effort, but it is through that effort that the baby bird's wings develop. And if the wings are not developed, the baby bird will come out, but it will not be able to fly. Its wings will not be able to carry its weight. And the baby bird will be easily devoured by any predator nearby. So similarly for us, Krishna is there watching. And Krishna is waiting, but it is we who have to break the shell. But when we are breaking the shell, by that, each time we break the shell, we are becoming stronger. So when we have to struggle against our situations, against our temptations, against our various provocations in our life, it might appear as if we are struggling all alone. But Krishna is waiting. Krishna is giving us the strength. And it is through that struggle that we become stronger and stronger. And we are all situated on some branches. Now the branches, we are on a shell, we are in a branch. The branch is like our material shelter. The branch can be our job, it can be our family, our health, our social position, our abilities. And all these are our present shelter. Now when a bird is on a branch, it is sheltered on the branch. But the bird doesn't live in chronic fear. Oh, if this branch breaks, I'll crash to my death. The bird is sheltered on the branch, but the bird has confidence in its wings. So even if this branch breaks, then I'll flap my wings and I'll fly away. So similarly for us, sometimes the very thing we are sheltered on seems to break. It just seems to break. And when it breaks, we say, what's happening in my life? But that's the time when our wings, if they've grown, then we fly from that one branch to another branch. During that branch, when we are flying, we don't know where is the next shelter. Will I crash? But we will find another branch to shelter. And if we keep doing like this throughout our lives, gradually our wings will become strong enough that at the time of death, our wings, we don't fly from this branch to another branch, we don't move from one material shelter to another material shelter, but rather we fly from the branch high into the sky. We fly by the power of our spiritual wings toward Krishna. So Krishna is our friend who is with us during our struggles, and he will be with us during our flight, ultimately towards him. And Krishna as God is not just our destination. It's not that at the end of our journey we will see him. Krishna is also our companion. Although we can't see him right now, he is there with us. Even if we can't see his actions right now, he is acting for us. And if we open our eyes to perceive all the things that whenever we are able to do anything right, see what all things went right at that time without my effort, we'll start seeing that Krishna is acting in our lives. And just as Krishna was there for Arjuna in all the situations where Arjuna was in trouble, we find that Krishna will be there for us whenever we need him. Krishna walks with us, but Krishna will not walk for us. Krishna will fight with Arjuna, but Krishna won't fight for Arjuna. It is Arjuna who has to fight. Similarly, we go through our struggles, but Krishna as our friend is always there with us. And he will walk with us, he will strengthen us, he will guide us, and ultimately, he will empower us to attain him. So this is the beauty of the friendship of Krishna with his various devotees. So I'll quickly summarize. I spoke today on this topic of the flavors of divine friendship. I started by talking about how God's greatness brings submission and his sweetness brings affection. And submission and affection both lead to strong devotion. Now, one way God manifests his sweetness is by exhibiting vulnerability. The world being brutally competitive, we put on a front of invincibility. But in front of those whom we trust, we take off that mask. And similarly, and when somebody takes off that mask, it brings intimacy. Oh, you trust me, so that you actually reveal your vulnerability. So Krishna has no vulnerabilities, but just for having intimate loving relationships, Krishna, the invulnerable Lord, becomes vulnerable. He wants his devotees not just to love him, to have a loving relationship with him, but to feel needed in that relationship. And he does that with Mother Yashoda, saying, I'm hungry and I need food and you have to provide it to me. And similarly, he does that with those who are in friendly relationships also. So with Madhumangala, we discussed how Krishna and Madhumangala, neither of them is conscious of their position. Krishna doesn't think I am God or I am Vaishya. Madhumangala doesn't think I am Brahmana. They're just friends loving each other. But whenever it's needed, Krishna will bring for Madhumangala's Brahminical position. And they don't have, in a sense, any work to do. It's work, but work is also play. So just sweet reciprocation of love in Vrindavan. Then I talked about the relationship with Sudama, where Sudama comes to Krishna and goes back. He comes with very little and goes with nothing. but actually he gets more than what he would have asked for. So the so in a relationship, there will be a material component of give and take, but that can be like a side interaction. The real interaction is the connection of the heart. So Madhumangala doesn't, Sudama doesn't even mention it because he forgets it actually. And Krishna doesn't mention it because he feels, in comparison with the love that Madhumangala is offering, what is the little bit that I can give him? So Krishna owns everything except one thing, and that is our heart. And if we offer the devotion of our heart, Krishna feels, oh, you are so charitable. Krishna feels grateful, and that's a udaraha. So that is, when we relate with Krishna, we may have some needs, we may ask sometimes, but that should never be the central point of the relationship. It's just incidental. And then we talked about primarily Krishna and Arjuna as operating in a mission in the world. That's how we also have to operate in the world. So Krishna and Arjuna, the first battle they fought together was in Kandav. And there Arjuna fought heroically and Krishna took the role of his charioteer. So right from the beginning, in these relationships, Krishna seems to take the lower role, the invisible role. Well, Arjuna is the heroic role. But after that, when benedictions are to be asked, Krishna's, let my friendship with Arjuna go on forever. That's how much Krishna, although he has that invisible role, he cherishes that friendship. And then I talked about toward the end, how on the 13th night, Arjuna takes that vow and Arjuna goes to sleep. And Krishna can't sleep. So the world may say, oh, Arjuna fought heroically and he won the war. But it is the bhakti commentators who reveal that it is Krishna who has an anxiety for protecting Arjuna. Similarly for us, just like Arjuna was on a chariot with Krishna and Arjuna was the main warrior, we are in the chariot of the body. And we may seem to be grappling with all our problems, but it is Krishna who is guiding us from within and who is clearing the path from us from without. And if we seem to be struggling, it is not because Krishna is uncaring. It is because that struggle is required for us to grow. It's like the struggle is required for the baby bird to come out of its shell so that its wings are strong enough so that it can fly. So for us, our struggles are ways in which we come out of our shell of attachment and ignorance. And the challenges that come in our life, the upheavals, they are like the branch under us breaking. That is the time when we test our wings and we fly to another branch, to some other shelter. And if we keep flying like this, serving Krishna and developing our spiritual wings, one day we'll become strong enough to fly all the way to Krishna. And although Krishna never walks for us, but he always walks with us. And in that way, Krishna is Suhridam Sarvabhutanam. He's the dearest of our friends. So let us conclude with a prayer to Krishna that his untiring affection and friendship and benevolence, that we start getting more and more realization of that, so that we can reciprocate with him and redirect our lives towards him. Sri Krishna Bhagavan ki. Yeah. Are there any questions or comments? Yes, bro. Yes, bro.
He has really long questions, but they're good. They're good. But that's not, that was more joke just between us. I just found it interesting how, in one sense, these devotees had their doubts or getting upset, at least Arjuna. So how are we to understand how they do? I mean, we don't see, at least I don't remember any instances where the cowherd boys ever had any doubts, you know, about Krishna, but yet, Arjuna and Draupadi, and there's probably other examples. It also makes me think of, in the Bible, when this is what they say, I have no idea what really went on, but when Lord Jesus was on the cross, he's on the cross suffering for so long, and then he says something like,
why have you forsaken me, O Father?
Yeah. So it's similar to these other doubts. So is this, is this, why would you have these doubts if you're really surrendered? I mean, they're pure devotees.
Yeah.
So how is it?
Yeah, that's true.
Anyway, so if you can just comment on these doubts.
So how can pure devotees have doubts? It said even Jesus, when he was being crucified, he cried out in despair, O Father, why hast thou forsaken me? And we don't see Vrajavasis having doubt, but Arjuna and Draupadi also had this kind of doubts. Firstly, I'm not sure whether the word doubt would be appropriate for this, because doubt is something much deeper. It's more of a circumstantially induced emotion. It is, doubt is where we question Krishna's existence or something like that. This is much more circumstantial, not so much deep rooted. As far as the Vrajavasis are concerned, there's no explicit like that, but the Vrajavasis do say to Krishna, Krishna, when the stormy rains start, say, Krishna, because of you, we stopped Indra Puja, and now see what Indra has done. Please do something to protect us. So it's not exactly a doubt, but it is, they're pointing out, Krishna, you got us into trouble. So now there are some incidents like that, even in Tamal Krishna Maharaj's TKJ's diary, the last days of Srila Prabhupada. So Prabhupada, that when he had a very long sickness, sometimes it appeared to improve and it didn't improve, and then it did improve and again it went back. So Tamal Krishna Maharaj writes, at one point Prabhupada said, why is this happening to me? Now Prabhupada also said at one time that when he was in Delhi and the cow hit into him when he was distributing back to Godhead, so Prabhupada said, why is this happening to me? And then we know that his god brother showed him that verse, Yasyaham Anugrahanami. Sridhar Maharaj showed him that verse. Those who have, Krishna says, are those whom I have special mercy, I take everything away from them. They have nothing except me left then. So then Prabhupada felt, I felt very comforted by him. So rather than seeing this as a doubt, or there is a, Vishwanath Chakravarti uses in a different context, he uses two words, Dushana and Bhushana. Dushana is contamination and Bhushana is ornamentation. So just like Krishna he exhibits a full gamut of emotions in his relationships. If Krishna is God, then how can he be so agitated by hunger that he becomes angry and he starts breaking pots? How can Krishna have a headache? The spiritual world is beyond all disease, death and all those problems of the world. How can Krishna get a headache? Krishna's body is transcendental. How can blood come out of his body when Bhishma's arrows hit him? So now in Krishna's case, it is whatever is required to enhance the Leela is done. So it's like if Krishna always acts like God and the devotee always acts like a pure devotee, then the breadth of the relationship will become restricted by that. So yes, the devotees are pure in the sense that their conviction to serve Krishna is never shaken. But some situations can evoke some emotions. That's why in the definition of bhakti, it is anya bhilashita shunyam. It is not anya bhilasha shunyam. There is no inclination to ask for any worldly things, to ask for anything other than Krishna. But although there is no inclination, sometimes by some situation, somebody might ask something. So, Draupadi, when she is in trouble, and she calls out to Krishna for help. Now, she is desperate at that time. You could say that somebody surrendered to Krishna, whatever happens, I don't care. No, but she calls out to Krishna. For her, it's It's a chastity, it's a dharma, it's her life for her in many ways.
Similarly, when Sita sees that deer,
she says, please get this deer. Now, if she has the Lord with her, why does she want a deer? In fact, it is said that she has the Lord and the deer is away. So, to get the deer, she sends the Lord away. Now, why would she do like that? Well, we could say that somebody might say that that's a contamination. But it's understood that, you know, she, her desire was that, oh, this deer, you know, it can be with us while we are in the forest and just 1 year is remaining. We'll go back. Such a beautiful deer it is. It will be like a memento that I'll give to Kaikai, my mother-in-law, later when we go back. A forest memento. So the point is that there is a full gamut of emotions that are exhibited and they flavor and sweeten the relationship. So when devotees, because of certain circumstances, some certain circumstantial emotions come up, that actually is an indication of the depth of their devotion. That although that emotion comes up, that emotion doesn't deviate them from their devotion. That means situations may trigger some emotions, but the determination to serve Krishna is never shaken. And that emotion, if it doesn't come, then it could also be said that they are so transcendental that we can never be like that. Situations will trigger certain emotions, but that those emotions are not the basis of their decisions. Burujan Prabhu, I think, writes in My Glorious Master that how once they had gone for a morning walk and suddenly it became very chilly. And then Prabhupada was still continuing instructing his disciples and he was talking with them. And then I don't remember all the details, but then he said, Prabhupada, isn't it very cold? And Prabhupada was continuing talking. Is it very cold or something like that? He asked Prabhupada. Prabhupada said that we can tolerate it for Krishna. So Prabhupada didn't say, I'm not feeling cold. He said, we can tolerate it for Krishna. So in many ways, the mind is just like the body. So when the weather goes cold, the body has a certain reaction. Similarly, when things go wrong, the mind has a particular reaction. But the soul is beyond the body and the mind. So because of certain situations, the body and the mind can have certain reactions which might not seem devotional. But the soul's determination to serve Krishna is so strong that in spite of those inimical, those unfavorable reactions on the body mind, the soul continues to serve Krishna. So, now in the case, this is how the Christians explain this about Jesus, that when he says that, oh Father, why have you forsaken me? Their understanding is that even one who is the Son of God, he can also, amid extreme provocation, go through moments of despair. But they are only moments. And after that, by the time eventually when he is about to end his life, at that time he says, forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. So that means that even for a pure devotee, sometimes what exactly is Krishna's plan may not be known. As we've seen in Markine Bhagavad Dharma also, that song which Prabhupada composed, there he says, Ache kichu karyata be ei anumane, nahe keno ani bena ei ugrasthane. So he says, Krishna, I think you must have some plan for me. Otherwise, why would you have brought me here? Now the word over there is anumane. Now anuman, it means guess. Now Prabhupada was strong that devotees don't rely on pratyaksha or anuman praman. We rely on shabda praman. But why Prabhupada is saying, this is my anuman, this is my guess. Krishna, you must have some plan. Now what does that mean? That means Prabhupada is also, it's not that Prabhupada was absolutely clear. I'll go here and this person will come over here. And I'll go there and this person will come over there. Prabhupada had faith that the spiritual master is my spiritual master has given me instructions and Krishna will make that instruction come true. But how exactly it will happen, we may not know. So that means we might invest ourselves fully in a particular course of action, and when that doesn't seem to be working, we might despair at that time. And that despair, rather than being seen as a contamination of the devotion, that despair is seen as an ornamentation of the devotion. That a devotee is so desperate to serve Krishna that the service is not coming. It's not that devotee is uncaring. A devotee is deeply emotionally invested. But, so, when a particular plan is not working, so when Prabhupada says that, Krishna, why is this happening to me? That when he was in his final days, that when Prabhupada was trying, maybe take the medicine, get healed, but he would get healed and again he would have a relapse, again he would be healed, have a relapse. So why, what is this happening? It means, what does Krishna want me to do? But eventually, when it became clear that Krishna wanted him to leave the world, and Prabhupada serenely accepted that. And that's why when he was asked finally, do you have any last desires? Prabhupada said, kuch ichcha nahi, no desires left. So that means when we are trying to serve Krishna in a particular way and that service is not working, or that service is completely going haywire, then naturally we may be disturbed by that. And that disturbance also indicates the intensity of the devotion. I remember in one early days, when I was just 2-3 years old in the Brahmachari ashram, one devotee had gone for book distribution and he had lost all the money. Just he had carelessly forgotten the bag somewhere. And then the Sankirtan in charge, he went and told him, actually, I lost that bag. Said, what? You lost the money? He says, no, don't get disturbed. Krishna tells in the Bhagavad Gita, we should not get disturbed by life's ups and downs.
So, now you will be saying you are not disturbed, but is it because you are so attached to Krishna that you are not disturbed by life's ups and by the loss? Or is it you are so irresponsible that you don't care for Krishna or Lakshmi?
So, now if somebody is concerned, when the Juhu land was being threatened, Prabhupada is concerned. Tamal Krishna Maharaj said that when they got the Mayapur land back, that night Prabhupada would usually sleep and wake up early so that he could do his translation. But that night when Tamal Krishna Maharaj came back, he was expected to come in the daytime, but he didn't come. So Prabhupada was awake late in the night. So Prabhupada had given Tamal Krishna Maharaj some Lakshmi in cash to go and give. And Prabhupada said later on, I was afraid that did somebody come and rob you or what happened. So that anxiety, that despair, that anger, it ornaments a devotee's devotion. So when we are trying to serve Krishna in a particular way and it's not working, a devotee might come up with a lot of intense emotions associated with that. But once it becomes clear, this is not what Krishna wants something else, then a devotee surrenders to that also. So that's why we see that Prabhupada was able to accept, Prabhupada was able to surrender. And that's how Arjuna also, at one level he was angry that Abhimanyu had been killed, but he didn't keep railing at Krishna. Although there was one circumstantial emotion, but now that's happened, it's over. I don't know why Krishna wanted to go like that, but it happened. But how can I serve Krishna now? So there is this dynamism of emotions in a devotee's life also. And if we try to suppress that emotion, thinking that, oh, I'm a devotee, I should not feel like this, then our devotion can become sometimes very artificial. We don't want to wallow in those emotions for a long time. But sometimes those emotions come up, that doesn't necessarily indicate a doubt in the devotion. It just indicates the intensity of the devotee's investment in that particular activity. Does that answer your question?
Yes, I have one quick question about this.
I don't know whether my answer will be quick.
I hope I get a quick answer.
Okay.
But your answer was very good. Just with Draupadi, why would she, you know, she told Krishna, where were you, why did you come? What did she think when this unlimited sari was coming, if she wasn't thinking that this is coming from Krishna? Where did she think this came
from? Yeah, okay. So what did she think about the unlimited sari? Well, definitely she called out to Krishna and she closed her eyes and the sari expanded. So generally what everybody thought over there was, sometimes in the Mahabharata movies or TV series you might see Krishna up there with his hands smiling and sari coming from him. It was not like that. It was all that happened, the sari just didn't get over.
Sorry,
Sari just didn't get, it did not get exhausted. It just kept coming and coming. So everybody over there thought that because of her chastity, the sari had become expanded so much. That, so now she prayed to Krishna, but he did not really see that it was Krishna reciprocating. Now, of course, it was Krishna reciprocating, but she had a personal relationship with Krishna and there was no personal intervention of Krishna over there. That's why she felt Krishna did not come, and then later Krishna came into the forest when they had already gone there. Okay, thank you. Yes, Ram.
Thank you very much for this wonderful address. Could you please explain the double portion of Arjuna, the double concept of Arjuna, where Krishna met Arjuna somewhere before the current Arjuna we know?
Sorry, I don't understand.
Yeah. What I mean that is the double concept of Arjuna. You said Krishna met Arjuna somewhere before.
Oh no, no.
Before.
Okay, no, no.
Now we know. So I want to explain.
No. It's not that Krishna met Arjuna earlier. What I meant was that there is a Gopa by the name Arjuna in Vrindavan. It's a different person. It is not the Pandava Arjuna. It is a Vrajavasi Arjuna. They just had the same name. So that same name, whenever Krishna would refer to Arjuna, he would remember the Arjuna of Vrindavan. And that's how he would be reminded of Vrindavan. It was not that Krishna and Arjuna, they had met over there. It is just that the name was similar to a character, Gopa in Vrindavan. Is that clear? Okay, thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
This is a little similar to what the argument was raising, but from the sadhaka's point of view. So we know as aspiring devotees that Krishna arranges whatever happens to us for our advancement. But it's not always clear what we should do to take advantage of that situation. So how can we know what the, I can accept whatever befalls me is Krishna's arrangement. He only does that for my advancement. But I don't always know what to do or how to react to that situation. So what are we doing in such a situation?
That's tough. Now, even if we know that something is for our advancement, how do we know what to do in that situation? Yeah, broadly speaking, bhakti has two aspects to it. One is dependence on Krishna, and the other is diligence for Krishna. So that which is not in our control, we entrust it to Krishna. I depend on you for that. And what is in our control, we do our best. We are diligent. Now, if we look at Srila Prabhupada's life, at one level, Prabhupada tried many different things. He tried to help his godbrothers start Gaudiya Math. He tried to earn money so that he could sponsor his spiritual master's mission. He tried to write back to Godhead, writing back, and distribute back to God in India. He tried to starting League of Devotees. And whenever each year, translating books. So he tried his best. And some things worked, some things didn't work. And Prabhupada moved on. So, it's phalena parichayate, we could say. That Prabhupada was fixed in purpose, but flexible in process. The purpose is, I want to serve Krishna. I want to carry on my spiritual master mission. But exactly how? Whatever works. So, there are different reasons, but Prabhupada was asked, Prabhupada himself raised the question once that do you know why I went to New York and not to London? That when he had to go, his godbrothers had gone to London, and at that time Bhaktivedanta Thakur also had planned eventually to go to London. There can be, we can say many reasons. That was pre-Second World War. After Second World War, London's stock in the world had gone down and New York was much more important city. But Prabhupada gave a disarmingly humble answer. He said that my godbrothers had gone to London and they had failed over there. So I thought, if I am going to fail, let me try at some other place. If I am going to fail, let me try at some other place. So, Prabhupada is trying, and Krishna arranged for Prabhupada to come at a time when the counterculture was there. And not that the audience was easy, but at least the audience was open. They took time to get convinced, but at least they were interested, and it worked out. So there is no clear, it's like the way I think about this is that sometimes we have street lights which on our path. You know, this is the path and this is how I'm going to go. But sometimes the street lights go off. Then we might groan or curse for a few moments, but then we turn on our flashlight. The flashlight doesn't replace the curse, the street light, but the flashlight can show us one step ahead. So Krishna, in this situation, what can I do? How do you want me to serve you right now? So generally, when things have going wrong in our life, at that time, if you start thinking about too much long term, 5 years, 10 years down the line, the variables are so many. If somebody has just lost a job or lost a loved one or lost their or got some serious disease, at that time you start thinking long term, then the sheer number of variables will overwhelm and crush us. So at that time, see, amidst unmanageably uncertain times, it's best to decrease our working frame of reference, to break our working frame of reference into manageable units of time. That means, okay, for the next coming day today.
Time's up.
That's a great and sweet way of indicating.
Okay, I'll just finish in a minute. Thank you.
So we need to, it's okay, we can just decrease the frame of reference to, for this one day today, can I do the best that I can? Or can I at least not make a mess of things for one day? So, one day I can do that. We all, even no matter how uncertain situations are, we can all know that there are many things, if we do it particularly, we can make things worse. Sometimes you may feel the situation is so terrible, I'm just powerless, I can't do anything. But no matter how bad things are, we can always make them worse.
I might have a fracture and I might be bedridden.
And I may say, I'm helpless, I can't do anything. But I can take a hammer and fracture my other leg also. So no matter how bad things are, we can always make them worse. And if we can make them worse, that means we are not as powerless as we think. If we can make them worse, that means we can make them better also. So we think, you know, how can I do the best that I can in this situation? And we do it for one day, that gives us some calmness, that gives us some confidence, that gives us some connection with Krishna. And then one more day. That's why about Prabhupada it is said that his head was in the sky, in the clouds, but his feet were on the ground. And that's how we work in our own small ways. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki. Shri Krishna Bhagavan ki. Itai Gaur Premanande. Jai.